house of 8-term member of parliament of Lok Sabha, a man who hails from Chindwara in Madhya Pradesh, a man who's never lost an election in Chindwara except the by-election of 1996. A man who's worked with Indira Gandhi and Sanjay Gandhi in the 1980s and went on to work with Rajiv Gandhi in the 80s. He is now by the side of Rahul Gandhi in the run-up to the Madhya Pradesh elections. The man who is known as the dynasty's very loyal person, Kamal Nath, Union Urban Development and Parliamentary Affairs Minister.
It's his home state of Madhya Pradesh going to the polls, and Kamal Nath has been trying to get the multiple leadership of the Congress party in the state on the same platform for star campaigner Rahul Gandhi to woo the voter. Back in Delhi, there are pressures on his time. But I finally get him to switch off his phones for our chat.
Hello and welcome to The Real Politic, Mr. Kamal Nath. It's very nice to have you. You're probably the longest serving politician as far as the UPA is concerned. You've seen many seasons in the Congress party. My question to you is, you've been a minister for 9.5 years. UPA won, the Congress and the UPA seem to be going great guns. But somewhere in UPA 2, you've been floundering. There seems to be a credibility crisis. Do you agree?
Well, you know, UPA 1 set into motion many things. And we must remember that in government also there's a learning process. As much as it's in the bureaucracy, as much as it's within the business community. Now, we set into motion momentum to the economy, which meant series of actions. Now, those series of actions are new to government. Let's take, for example, PPAs, public-private partnership. Now, what is the right one? We never had any PPAs, public-private partnerships, PPPs, before. Now, when this went into motion, when we were saying take roads, we'll have toll roads, and this toll will fund the building of these roads. What is the ideal PPP agreement? Similarly, if you have a PPP in anything in our metros, what is the ideal one? How does it fly? How do you make it transparent? Now, this is a learning curve for government, and I think this is where UPA 2 ran into problems, that a lot of things were challenged in the court. Now, the court looks at one dimension of it. There is another dimension that we got to make it happen. How do you make these converge? How do you make transparency, speed, the execution of this, of these projects converge?
Coming specifically to the Colgate issue, which is right now the headlines everywhere, the issue is you've got 14 FIRs now, the latest one against the biggest and the probably among the most respected names in business, Kumar Mangalam Birla, and the most respected bureaucrat of his time, P.C. Parakh. And nowhere in this do we see any finger being pointed out at any politician, at any minister who handled this, including the Prime Minister. The question that goes out is the government specially shielding itself from the onslaught of these investigations and just passing the buck on to whoever it can find in the way?
You are right. A very, very credible and a very prominent bureaucrat, undoubtedly a very prominent and a very good industrialist. Now, what is the issue here? That if the issue is process, okay, this is where I was saying that there's a big learning curve in this. We must recognize one thing, that we've had, we got the fourth largest coal reserves in the world. We got power plants or other industries which require coal struggling. There was no coal allocation policy, either in the NDA time or the UPA time. The UPA continued with what the NDA was doing, that you allocated. Now, nobody's saying this coal was taken and sold in the market. This coal was for either a power plant or for some other industry. What is the fastest way to do it? If we get into framing a policy and then framing a policy which again will be challenged, there's nothing which is 100% perfect in this. You can punch holes into anything.
But then why find fault with industrialists and bureaucrats, no, but not with the political masters?
It's not that the government is prosecuting them. It's the CBI. Here the Supreme Court directed the CBI. CBI says, well, fine, they got it. This was a process. He met so-and-so. Now, that may be absolutely absurd. It may be absolutely absurd, but this is it. This is the complexities of governance in our country.
But isn't it also absurd, and you've said this in the past, that the Prime Minister, if summoned by the CBI, will come and appear before the CBI. Isn't it absurd that the signing authority, who's also the Minister of Coal at that time, the Prime Minister himself, and that's what the senior most bureaucrat at that time has pointed out, that he was also the competent authority who was signing this. So why questions only to the industrialist and the bureaucrat and no questions to the Prime Minister who was the Minister for Coal?
It's not the question of the Prime Minister. I sign so many files which come to me. Now, this has been put up, everybody has said this is it, and I sign it. Not that I've looked into minutely into every page which has been put up.
So you're saying the politicians will never have any accountability, it will always stop at the bureaucrat?
We have a political executive. And the question is whether the political executive instigated it, drove it to such a situation. Nobody is saying that the Prime Minister is corrupt. Nobody is saying there's anything wrong in it. We are talking about the process. Now, the governmental process where it goes up to the political executive is there. That's in everything. Now, this way, nobody is accountable, only the minister who finally signs the file. There are so many files which have come to me in my ministerial career where I cannot even remember that you have just signed it because this was what everybody had said. This was what was generally agreed. They are supposed to have gone into it. They are supposed to have examined it from all points of view. So I signed it. Now, am I to be held responsible?
So it's always the senior most bureaucrat where the buck will stop?
No, it is the system. That is the system. How does the government function? Now, if you say the Prime Minister directed it, the Prime Minister said, give this to Mr. Birla. He did not. Nobody, that's not the charge. The charge is, he happened to be the coal minister at that time. Now, if he happened to be the coal minister and everybody had said this, is the Prime Minister, who is also the coal minister, to be looking at every minute aspect, who met whom, what were the reasons?
So that's the immunity that the CBI is giving him, that he's not supposed to be looking at the minute details?
It's not the immunity. The CBI is looking at it factually. That where did it start? Did it start at the expert's end? Did it go through a committee? Did it not go through this? Then who's supposed to be?
But those questions were not raised by the Prime Minister on file.
No, it's still there. I mean, the CBI may choose, I don't know, to even talk to the Prime Minister on this.
So you're saying that option is open, that the Prime Minister could be questioned?
That is for the CBI to decide, not for me. If the CBI, I think all options are always open to the CBI. They've got to exercise their judgment that what will assist in the investigation.
And if that happens, would the Prime Minister be willing to talk about his tenure as a coal minister? I mean, that's probably never happened before. Are you saying it's a possibility that is in the realm of reality?
The Prime Minister is a citizen of this country. The law applies to him equally. If the CBI believes that it's going to assist in their investigation, well, and they ask him some questions, he would certainly reply because he's nothing to hide. The law is not above him. So why not?
But you're saying the CBI is not under the control of the government. When it comes to other issues like Ishrat Jahan, Amit Shah, the CBI virtually seems to be going after the opposition party MP.
Do you think the Prime Minister, who's trying to send a good economic signal, told the CBI, arrest, file a charge sheet against Mr. Birla? Do you think against all the industrialists which has been filed, the Prime Minister said so, please do it?
The allegation is that Mr. P.C. Parakh accused before he becomes a witness, and that's the big plan of the government.
There is no big plan. I don't think we should say the CBI is acting at the behest of the government. There are some cases which are going totally against the government. The CBI filed so many affidavits in the court which made the government embarrass the government. Let's face that. Why don't you talk about those? You're not talking about those. You only picked up two or three. You picked up the Ishrat case because you say this doesn't suit us. Now, if something doesn't suit somebody, that doesn't mean that becomes the rule.
But Mr. Kamalnath, the question is the CBI's latest actions. Does it bring us back to the raid Raj of the 1980s during the VP Singh government, and has it shaken up investor confidence? You've been commerce and industry minister in the past. How do you see this vis-a-vis investor confidence in the country?
Of course, this will shake up investor confidence, because you see a person of the stature of Mr. Kumaramangalam Birla, and he is being charge-sheeted. I think that's, I wouldn't agree with that at all, because you would send a wrong signal. Today, investment is an act of faith. And unless people have that faith in investment, investment has to be attracted. It cannot be driven. And unless you're going to be doing that, create an atmosphere of investment, it's not going to happen. So we've got to be very careful in this. This is very unfortunate, I must say, for investor investment.
And how do you address the problem in the government?
Well, the CBI has acted. CBI has acted. Now you say the government is not happy about it. But if the CBI says in the process of its investigation, we are going ahead with this, they didn't ask the government, should we do it? Okay, I think it must have come as a big surprise to those who were connected with this.
Mr. Kamalnath, as far as the credibility issue, the investment issue that we spoke about, another issue that really puts a question mark over the credibility of this government is the ordinance issue.
I don't think so at all. Many times in cabinet, decisions have been changed. When you find the reaction is not all right. Now, Rahul Gandhi, when he looked at it, he found public reaction, there's a public outcry into it. He thought he must step in. And that's what he did. He just voiced what he thought. And the cabinet looked at it. I wasn't in the cabinet meeting, but I'm not shirking it, which approved it. I was not in Delhi that day. But it is so that the cabinet approved it. There was public dissent on it. There was public outcry on this. So the cabinet reconsidered it, that this has happened. There are feelings, strong feelings. Until we can explain this better to the people, why this is so or why this is not so, let's shelve it. We shelved it.
It's as simple as that.
Absolutely. I don't think this is, well, why should it be such a big deal?
Welcome back, and now we talk about the rough and tumble of election politics. Mr. Kamalnath, you come from a state called Madhya Pradesh, Chhindwara, your stronghold for 8 elections now. You've never lost the seat except one by-election in 1996, I think. The question really is that Madhya Pradesh, despite all big wig leaders coming from there in the Congress party, Digvijay Singh, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, Suresh Pachauri, Arjun Singh in the past, Ajay Singh now, all of these leaders coming from that one state, including yourself. Yet, for 10 years, we've seen Shivraj Singh forming the government over there, and there's been a crisis of sorts as far as the Congress is concerned in the multiplicity of the leadership. Is that going to be once again the battle for the Congress?
Well, there won't be an 11th year for Shivraj Singh Chauhan. Let me make it clear. We are united. The BJP came in after 10 years of Congress rule, let's face it. And they said, give us a chance. People said, let's give them a chance. Now they've got a chance for 10 years. And I don't think they're going to get another chance. And all of us have now unitedly are coordinating with each other, are engaging with each other in the strategy, in the campaign.
You have been accompanying Rahul Gandhi to various rallies in Madhya Pradesh, and we've seen a more aggressive form of Rahul Gandhi post the ordinance controversy, if we can call it that.
See, Modi doesn't dictate how Rahul Gandhi would campaign. Be clear on that. Rahul Gandhi has its own views. He has his own thoughts. He has his own style. And nobody dictates it. So it's not that he's turned aggressive. I've seen him like this all throughout. It's not that he's changed since the last 3 weeks. It depends who you are addressing, it depends where you are, it depends what are the kind of people who are there. So it's nothing to do with his change of style, that's him.
Do you see the 2014 elections becoming a more presidential form of election, Rahul Gandhi versus Narendra Modi?
You know, I think the media seems to get it all wrong in this, very, very urban centric. Our country is a very complex country. Elections are very localized. We must understand this.
So you're saying neither is there a Rahul magic nor is there a Modi magic?
No, it depends what is the atmosphere you create for your party, for in the perception of people. That's it. But at the end of the day, it's how what is your organizational structure at a booth level, at a constituency level. Number two, what are the issues in the constituency?
Mr. Kamalnath, on a personal note, do you ever resent the fact that you came into the cabinet committee for political affairs fairly late into the UPA?
I don't resent anything. I'm not in the running. I do what I'm supposed to do, and I do it with the honesty of purpose.
That was a very interesting chat that we had with you, Mr. Kamalnath. We wish you all the very best for elections in Madhya Pradesh and, of course, the big ones in 2014. And we hope we'll travel to your district and travel to your constituency and see how Chindwara is faring in the run-up to the 2014 elections. Thank you, Mr. Kamalnath.
Interview done, I get the restless Kamalnath to speak about his relationship with the three generations of Gandhis, Indira Gandhi, Sanjay Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi, and now Rahul Gandhi.
Mr. Kamalnath, you're among the few leaders in the Congress who worked with generations and generations of the Gandhis. You started in the 70s and you worked with Indira Gandhi. You've got their photographs up on the wall here. You worked with Sanjay Gandhi. You even studied in Dhoon School with him. And it was said that when the Gandhis visited Dhoon School, they took two boys out for an outing. And Kamalnath and Sanjay Gandhi were the do haath of Indira Gandhi. Do you remember those days, and what was your relationship with Sanjay Gandhi like?
Well, it's a long time ago. Sanjay was in school with me and we were friends. And that friendship drove me coming into politics. I'm a politician by default, not by design. And when we had the emergency at that time, I got driven into it.
Sanjay ke chokre, that was the
word.
Yeah,
I remember that when we came into parliament in the 7th Lok Sabha, one of the very senior congressmen, very eminent congressman, said, "Ye sab chokre aa gaye hain." And, people thought that a young generation has come. That was a generational change which was taking place.
And when you lost Sanjay Gandhi and made the switch over and then started working with Rajiv Gandhi, how was that transition?
It was good, of course. It was a big, it was painful that Sanjay Gandhi had died. And Rajiv came into it. He was not at that time completely into it. He was getting into it. And Rajiv was far more softer than Sanjay. Both had a different style. Sanjay was an absolute doer. Not that Rajiv wasn't, but Rajiv had a vision. He had a vision of India into the 21st century. And all this IT and all this what he created, the modernization of the railways, these were his visions. So Rajiv, with that vision, there were very few people who were thinking. They thought if computers come in, everybody will lose their jobs.
And then you worked with Sonia Gandhi and now you're touring the hinterland with Rahul Gandhi. How's it been seeing another generational shift?
Well, everybody has a different way, but there's one common line, there's one common denominator amongst all of them, that their thought process and what they think in their hearts and in their minds. They think, they are always thinking for the weaker sections. You know, you got to make industry grow, you got to create jobs. But on the other hand, like take the food security bill. It was Mrs. Sonia Gandhi who was driving it, and she just wanted that. If we got so much of food, why should anybody go to bed hungry?
So UPA 3 with Rahul Gandhi is a distinct possibility?
I think so. I hope so. I wish so.
That was Kamalnath clearly pointing out that UPA 3 is what the leaders of his generation are looking at, and it's a natural transition from Sanjay Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi, Sonia Gandhi, and now to Rahul Gandhi.
He says he's a politician by default, but the crowds that line up at his home every single day don't think so, because their welcome to this one Tughlaq Road home of Kamalnath is legendary, and he never lets them down and always meets them whenever he's in town.
It's time for Madhya Pradesh elections, and there is a horde of people to meet Mr. Kamalnath. After all, he's the strong man from Chindwara, and this has always been, in any season, whether it's elections or not, open season as far as Kamalnath's home is concerned. Members of his constituency, members of his state are always allowed to come in, and he meets with each one of them at a given time in any working day, however busy he may have been.
His daily meetings done, it's time to work the phones from his home office and attending to the election agenda.
This week, Kamal Nath and the man and the insight into his politics. Next week, we'll get you another interesting politician on The Real Politics.